Welcome back. We're here at Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we're speaking with Anthony Laciura. We spoke about your teaching with young people, and something came to mind at the moment, and it is the young singers of today, how are they different than the time when you were a young singer? What's different?
That is such a good question, and so manifold in a sense in a response. We were taught, as I said, with the teachers who came always with this idea of appoggiare, the abdominal support of the body feeling it's expanding down and out so that the soft palate rises and the laryngeal position lowers. Now, you're telling somebody that, is that what you're doing? No, you're not doing that because there's other aspects to it, but we were taught in that fashion so that this domed area, like the old-time cathedrals we have in our heads already, like Caruso had this, put an egg in his mouth, to utilize that so that the tone would spin forward, not sort of women singing like little boys, but women singing like women. And all of us delving to find how we utilize this open space, this aperta, in our throats, like Corelli, Delmonico, Sutherland, Jackie Horn, all these great singers of the time that we were growing up, Martina Arroyo, Leontipo, that had this wonderful, solid connection to their body. I don't know if that's still happening. I still teach that. I don't know if it's popular. There are others who teach the same thing that are around, and you sort of can tell because the quality of the sound is so gathered and so full-bodied and at the same time can be pulled back because it's in, you know, I don't want to get too technical. People will be listening to this, oh, that Anthony Laciura sang character roles. He's full of shit. But it's, you know, why? Because you touched on this while we were at the break, because I went through a difficulty vocally in my career and had to pretty much put my voice back together again. And it was very difficult. And the reason was I had stopped studying, and I was trying to keep the sound that I entered the Metropolitan Opera with. And God said, no, that's not natural. Das ist not natürlich. It's not natural to do. You have to let your voice open. So I worked with a teacher that was not so good. Then I found another teacher that's boom, boom, started to go up and down beautifully, Bonnie Hamilton. And then I went to Dr. Robert White and combined everything that they both had with my own knowledge of 17 years of my own teacher as a child, put it back. And you know how I started back? Vacai and the Italian art songs. Because my teacher always said to me as a child, when you leave here, if you can't sing the first exercise in Vacai, you have a problem. But sing it and work it, and it'll come back to you. And sure enough, that's what happened. So I had to pull everything apart and put everything back together.
What was the period like psychologically? Was it
unbelievable? Unbelievable. But I'll tell you, and I'm not ashamed to say it, I have a strong faith, and I knew this was a reason for this. This wasn't because what people say, God giveth and God taketh away. That's not true. God giveth. If you want to keep it, you got to work at it. My father used to always say, God helps those that help themselves. So that's what I did. I said, oh, no, I have a young kid. I need to, this has to, and plus, this is my gift. I can't put it I can't take that light and put it under a bushel or hide it or any of that thing. I have to keep going. And I did, and I worked, and I found such a wealth of things that I did naturally as a young person. And now I had to read and find out how that works with the tip of the tongue and what really is bel canto singing. And it's that it's not just, not just gargling. But that it's the head, the tongue, the appoggia, the text, how to sing like the Italians do, consonants. You sing a consonant, and that's incredible. So, yes, that was a difficult time, and I lost roles in so doing. I lost work. but I knew it was going to benefit, and now...
What were you thinking during that time when you are really...
I'll be exact. I made my European debut in Geneva, mm-hmm. and it was during this period where the old was leaving, the new was coming, and neither one of them sounded good. Mm. So I was in the middle, and I'm making my European debut as the simpleton in Bars Good Enough. Thank God it was that. I would do rehearsals, and the intendant at that time was trying everything possible to get rid of me. Mm. But Ado de Waard was the conductor and said, fire him, you fire me. Mm. Mm. It's just that simple. I hired him. I want him to do this part. Well, as it turned out, it was lousy. I mean, I was having a lot of vocal difficulty. The best reviews I ever got in my entire life
really?
Were in Geneva. And the ovation when I would walk out as the simpleton, because I had the bow next to Sam Raimi, who was the Boris.
Uh-huh.
I came and then he... And it was like it matched.
Is that
I
right?
said, oh, God in heaven. I'm sounding like I'm giving birth.
Sure, sure.
And the audience, I was cracking. I sounded like the 4th of July with the fire. One night, I had friends from America coming over. They were thrilled. It was one of the worst nights. I left, went into the dressing room, collapsed, cried my eyes out, mm-hmm. praying and crying. And I remember Tony Ralph Johnson was doing the Schwiski, and he came into the, he said, Anthony, and he saw me. I said, oh, no, it's all right. Well, I said, no, you've tried to help me. I know what it is. I know exactly what it is, but I can't change now. I have to stick to what I've decided so that, and I would listen to Luciano, and I heard what he was doing. So I can do that, and that's exactly what happened. I worked and worked.
How long did it take?
9 years.
9 years.
And I kept performing during those 9 years mm-hmm. as much as I could. And I remember one evening at the Met, I was doing a Turandot, and Placido was in was in Joe's box, and he said to Joe, who's the Pong? He says, that's Anthony. Jesus, he sounds great. That was the end. Remember I told you about fattening
sure.
the turkey for the kill?
That's right.
The voice started becoming, I kept telling, I said, no, I don't want any leading roles. That's not what I do. I love to be able to create something. Well, that's all right. So.
People always remember you. I think that's important.
Isn't that wonderful?
Yeah.
I was so fortunate. Isn't that nice? I'm so happy about that. I loved my audiences. I loved entertaining them. Yeah. I loved that they would come back and feel sad. We felt sad, but we saw you, and we read in the program that you were doing Monsieur Triquet, and we just felt so good, you
mm-hmm,
know?
Mm-hmm.
So that...
I think we need to hear you and watch you in action.
Okay.
In one of these roles. The one we picked is Franz.
Great. That's one of my favorites.
Tales of... One of your favorites. What's unique about this role is that it's not just one role, right?
It's four.
Four roles.
Yes.
A young guy, and
that's
then he
right.
becomes sort of a crazy...
That's right.
A scientist assistant. Then I hunchback, and then finally
and then
the
France.
The France, the deaf domestique.
La
la la la la la la la la la la la la.
Looks like you're having a good time, too.
I always had a good time. I always did. Even when it was difficult, even in Geneva when things were, I thought, but no, I'm going to give you a performance.
Right.
I have to. It's what I'm supposed to do.
You know, that's the question I would like to ask you. during the so-called crisis of your voice, do you think, because you're such a good actor, and timing is so right, so do you think that sort of help you, your voice part of it, do you think?
It didn't hurt, okay? But it happened because it was supposed to happen, and I was trying to stop. I was trying to stop what was natural, a natural occurrence of maturation, just growing and expanding. And some voices have to go through that, and even Jimmy said, you know, I listed the whole bunch of people that went through, and a lot of singers that you have no idea went through the same thing. It was able to, even Luciano did for 6 months, off, regrouped, came back for Hernani and sang. I was almost more glorious, if that could possibly be, than he was doing before. So it's just getting it and all, getting it to the mold and to the, and so it's just the, it's just that when you go back to the old way and the voice fills out, you sort of lose your position as a comprimario or supporting artist. And you say, well, we have so-and-so singing the leading thing. And I was in Washington and doing Goro, and one of the assistants said, you think you could sing a little softer because we don't know who's the Pinkerton and who's the Goro? And I said, well, maybe you should have hired an adult to sing Pinkerton. And to answer your question, no.
Right.
Son of a bitch. Huh? Lousy me. But you know,
right.
No, and Placido was conducting. It was it was just glorious. I was singing like full bow. You know, it was just this glorious. I said, I'm enjoying myself too much.
I'm dying to ask you one question, if you'll allow me, and that is, I've heard you in several roles do a, shall I call it a gesture or a popping sound that became somewhat of a signature of yours?
Yes.
Thank you. That's it. And where did that start?
Fritz Feld on television in the old movies of the 40s and the 50s, because he always, table for two. And he would walk just that. And he got it from another German. So when I saw that as a kid, and I was a kid, how do you do that? Because I could always do, I can't do that anymore. But I said, he did. And then he had that little thing with the, I said, this is too great. I need to do this. So I just practiced.
How many, do you know how many roles you've worked it into?
Almost all of them.
And what do the stage directors say? They say,
well, the British ones hate it. The Germans love it. Adi Schenk loved it. I remember doing
Frosch. Is it in Frosch? Do you do it in
Frosch? I do it in Frosch when I do it on my own. I didn't do it with him because I never did Frosch at the Met. I covered Adi, and he already told me in notes. He says, I will crawl on the stage. You're not, I can't, it makes no difference how sick. You're not doing Frosch. He taught me so much. All the old-time things, the kicking of the hat, the turns, all of that. But we're doing Arabella, and I was the Zimmer Kellner. And you had that one line, auf Nummer 8 darf ich nicht mehr servieren, außer wünschen sofort zu bezahlen. And that's where I put it. And Leinsdorf was but didn't have this rehearsal. It was, I forget now. But when I did that, they said he fell out of the chair and rolled down. And I got the message. Everybody was coming back to my job. Did Adi tell you you could do that? This is my first year at the Met. I said, no, I just thought I'd put it in. It was, you know, it was a nice little spot. Did Otto tell you you could do that? And then Phoebe Berkowitz, who was the assistant, came and she said, well, I said, everybody seems to be a nervous wreck. What the hell is this? And so she said, he loves it, but you can't do it there. You can do it after you sing and pop. So when we did the final dress and Leinsdorf is in the pit, I went there. He went, because for some unknown reason, we got along very, very well, because at that time I was doing Spallanzani, and we're combining rehearsals of Spallanzani and something else, Adriano Lecouvreur, and Arabella, and it, since it was just a small role, and Adi gave me a whole bunch of stuff to do with the hand first. Brilliant, brilliant stuff. And I would come in for a rehearsal, and lines of, "Well, Mr. Laciura, you're gracing us with your presence." Yeah. I said, "Talk to management." So we got along. So it was really nice. They all said, Langstoff smiled when Anthony popped. Langstoff smiled. Langstoff smiled. It's like that old Big Bugs Bunny.
Right.
Leopold. Leopold is here. Leopold, when he goes on. What a life, huh?
Yes. That's right.
Filled with
miracles.
It's
wonderful. I mean, you know. So that difficult time, after that, then were you thinking, say, okay, I'm going to continue to do this, and whatever it takes.
Yeah, exactly right. That's exactly what I thought of. I did it, and I went, and then I saw that all these other newer directors coming in wanted the supporting characters to be a little more white and blend in. Mm-hmm. And I thought, it's time for Anthony to go after 27 years, because mm-hmm. it's not. So I left, and I looked for teaching positions. Nobody wanted me. And then finally, after a year and a half of no work, I started teaching a little bit. And then I got a job teaching at New Jersey City University and built an opera program for them. And then I left there. And right in the middle of that, I got hired for Boardwalk Empire, which was a wonderful 4.5 years. Now I've been directing a...
When you auditioned for that, what is the key moment for you to get that job?
Well, you see, I was such a new person in this world. So when I went in, I went in for the first audition, dressed three-piece suit, the works. And I walked in and I went to Christi. I am a bit nervous because I am auditioning for... Martin Scorsese, who's probably the greatest film director in the world since Lina Wertmüller. And I am stuttering because I am translating from the German into the English. So you know what I am feeling. I am saying to you. And they said, Mr. Laciura, what part of Germany are you from? I said, from the South Bronx. So what I didn't know after that was the woman that was the casting director goes into her friend, who happened to be Steve Buscemi's production company, and said, "We found Eddie Kessler. I hope Marty likes him." And so then, about 2 or 3 weeks later, I'm doing Frosch in Princeton. They said, "Anthony, come in. You know, Marty wants to meet with you and talk with you. You know, he wanted to read for him and Terry Winter." So, I don't know. I dressed the same way, the pocket watch, tout à cause, everything. So I walked in and shook hands. I said, "You know, we met at the Metropolitan Opera." And he said, "Macropolis case. You were the old man." I said, he said, who was that woman? That woman was terrific. I said, that was Catherine Malfitano. You know, that was a terrific production. And you were wonderful. And so we started talking. Now, this doesn't happen. You right. go in, you do your thing, and you leave. So
That's
your
right.
audition takes about a minute.
That's right.
Maybe a minute 30. I'm in there 25 minutes talking
wow.
about directors, film directors that I had worked with in Los sure. Angeles, and this and his mother and father, and everybody going on and on and on talking about it. He said, "Well, you want to read?" I said, "Sure, let's do it." Boom, boom, we're read. That was a Monday. Wednesday, I got a call. "You're Eddie Kessler," at which point I was in Princeton. I picked up the phone. I had an exhausting day of rehearsing and been putting in a new soprano and everything. And Megan called and said, "Well, Anthony, how's it?" I said, "Oh, I'm tired, Megan." She said, I said, "What can I do for you?" She said, "Well, you're Eddie Kessler." And I started to cry because at that point I thought, well, I'm content directing and teaching in a university. And all of a sudden, a miracle occurred. And I got to have another career that I've always wanted. 1951, grew up with television, Uncle Milty, I Love Lucy.
Right.
That's what I want to do.
Yeah.
So that's what the, and I got that. That's another miracle. Met miracle. baby miracle, marriage miracle, yeah. A lot of miracles. You want to touch me?
Speaking of miracles, this ability of yours for dialects and languages, you were born without words, but do you speak some of these languages fluently?
I watched as a kid Sid Caesar. Sid Caesar used to do all the fake French, Russian, German, Italian, and he used to use it when he would travel all over the world. He'd throw in, Tour Eiffel, on entend bien, ce sera, oh. Je suis son bien, donc on va me dire ça. Ouais. Je m'en vais, simplement. Nobody. And I used to do it. I went to some Russian women and I went, Louis. And a couple words, and they're looking at you like, what is he saying? Isn't that fun?
So this show will last you 4.5 years.
Yeah.
That's a long.
It was great, great people, great crew, great everything.
Mm-hmm. Where was it filmed?
It was filmed in Williamsburg, Brooklyn. We built an entire boardwalk, the boardwalk of Atlantic City. I mean, it's so perfect to the rust from the salt water that you saw, which was, of course, no salt water. It was all on a blue screen.
What do you think of Marty?
I think he's a brilliant genius. Mm-hmm. So well-read. He knows. He's like a living encyclopedia. He knows that. He just knows, and he talks. And we were filming one day. We were talking about Tosca. I said, you know, the set looks like the room Scarpia's office. He said, I remember when you did that. What was that? I said, Spoletta. Yeah, that was good. I love that opera. And she throws him, and they said, Marty, we're ready. Can't you say I'm talking to Anthony? I'm talking to Anthony here. We got along so well. He gave me a fantastic bottle of a single malt 18-year-old Highland Park scotch. So I went to him, and I put candy in my ear, and I went, Mr. Scorsese, I would like to thank you for the beautiful bottle of scotch, and I hope that your next child will be a masculine one. He said, you know, you're a crazy son of a bitch. Get the hell out of here. Go back on the set and do something. Act.
What a terrific thing.
And, was that fun? He let me do Eddie. He let me improvise so much in the pilot.
That's
that was
wonderful.
Unbelievable.
That's wonderful.
A lot of the stuff that I said, especially when Nookie, they're knocking, I'm banging on the door because I hear him screaming. Of course, he's making love with or whatever he was doing with the powers.
You have such a big band to walk out that show. What's it like?
To not be on it anymore?
Yeah.
It's very difficult, but I still keep in touch with so many of the people. Mm-hmm. And one of the Focus Puller and I want to start our own production company because we're doing a web series, hopefully, called Eat, Drink, and Sing with Anthony Laciura. And it's not like the other things. We're eating, we're drinking, we're singing, we're acting. Steve Buscemi is juggling. Martina Roy is throwing him lemons so he can juggle. I'm singing, Tootsie, goodbye.
So, describe your last scene, walk out.
I folded all of the, he yelled at me for not folding the socks. So I folded the socks, put those in, went into my room. There was a little lapse of time because I showered, changed suits, shaved, make sure I had cologne, aftershave on, and then I walked to the window and jumped out. And that was it.
On that note,
we have to stop.
You jumped out the window. Oh, too bad.
What a fabulous
I'll come back.
Well, that's great. I think we've only begun.
It's wonderful.
Yes. Well, thank you.
Thank
I
you
had
for
a great
sharing
time.
All this with us. We've been here today with Anthony Laciura. This is Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis.